Hi everyone, welcome back. So in this session I'm going to talk about the new UI framework and the UI frameworks we have developed for JREC and ES. I think most of you were here for the previous one as well, so somewhat related to that in terms of the UI work we have we have been doing so far and what we plan to do in the future. So I'm going to go through why we started doing this whole UI framework and UI innovation thing, and then what we have done so far with the API manager and with ES and JREC, and what we are coming up and what's the next step for us. So so if you look at UI creation, the most easiest thing to do if you just starting up a UI, you ad hocly start developing it, right? You start writing some CSS, HTML and JavaScript. So again, as you can see, as a company, WSO2 is doing more and more end user UIs. Earlier we had a lot of admin facing UIs, but now with JREC 5 and ES2 and dashboard server, all these are meant to be used with our customers, that is your customers. So this is actual end user facing products, and we want them to be polished, we want them to look good, and so we have started creating a lot of UIs. So the advantages with just creating UIs is it is unlimited customizability, right? Whatever you can write with CSS, JavaScript and so forth, you can write it, right? And it is less learning curve if you already have developers who are familiar in this domain. Of course, you can hire people who have worked in UI with UI stuff, so they'll already know CSS and HTML and so forth. And that's easy, right? They not easy, it's a lot of work, but still they know what to do. But the problem is when we have a huge product suite like WSO2, the advantages soon end, and we start seeing a lot of problems with just going ahead and creating each UI individually. So first of all, the biggest problem is repetitive tasks, right? So every UI is going to have a login screen, every UI is going to have some navigation panel and things like that. So when you'll say, okay, then in that case I'll write some CSS HTML piece and then I can reuse it in all the places. The problem with that, it's not just bit of CSS and HTML and so forth, it is all also coupled into the logic as well, right? If you are talking about login process, it is coupled to the backend that does the login. So we are talking about something that has both UI capabilities as well as some backend logic running for it, and we want to inject that part into various different UIs. And if we just go ahead and do it, we'll have to do this for all the products individually. And another problem we see within WSO2 as well currently is that we have lot of UIs, and they are all they start out the same but they diverge over time because we keep on specializing a product, and that gains its own set of libraries and its own set of own way of doing things, because each developer who does that piece of UI thinks, okay, this is not nice, so I can put this stuff into a library, I can bring that library into make the process better and so forth. But the decisions each group, each group takes is different, and therefore end source code repositories being very divergent, and you need to learn a little bit about the product before you can contribute, you can customize, and so forth. Right? I'll come to the why you need to customize part next, but each customization of the UI is a special branch. Again, so the UI is in special in the way that it is very heavily customized by our customers, that's you, right? So unlike our Java code, right, which will be customized but only using special extension points, UI is frequently customized by everyone, and at least everyone want to put their logo in, right? That's basic minimal requirement for any product to be brought into a company. So everyone, almost everyone, does some customization, and then they'll end up maintaining that customization, and that will be a different source code base. And the problem is within WSO2 also we have done some the same mistake. Not just our customers. We have taken some products, and some other team when tries to use that product just branches that product and keep on developing there. So eventually you end up with two code bases where you earlier had one. Again, so much more disadvantages. And another thing is for us, we issue patch first of all, we there's no way to like change a partial particular place only in a particular UI. So if you want to go ahead and change a particular UI piece, you need to load up the whole UI and change the whole how the whole UI behaves, and that might break some other place in the UI. And this one is very important for us. That is, we issue patches when you report some issues, right? So for all our paying customers, when there's when you report this, you know, a bug or issue, or even special cases some improvements, we give you as a patch. So the problem with UI patches is when you have already customized the UI, if we give you a patch, that patch is going to override your customizations, and that's not very good, and that limits us to give patches and give fixes, correctively do upgrades to your system once it's already deployed, right? And the next point is the upgrading cost is higher for the customer. So if you get a WSO2 product, and when you change the UI, and when the new WSO2 version rolls out, you either want to go and do all the same UI customizations to that new product, and or you have to do that basically manually. So that is something we want to avoid in order to reduce cost for you to migrate to new versions of our products. Okay. So the next point is more of an internal problem, which is since when the UI is developed ad hocly, we often don't get a chance to go back and review and design again and again, because mostly the designers are if we brought in external, like just UI specific expertise, they often don't want to get involved when there's a lot of coding functionalities already involved, right? They focus on the UI aspects, so we need it limits us in the capability to bring in UI or user experience expertise and just get them to work on the code base, because if the UI is already complicated by the time they were brought in, because these are not back-end developers, they find it hard to contribute. Okay. So to solve all these problems, so we have We have first in API Manager, we have introduced a certain block model design pattern, and then in later we have introduced the caramel what we call caramel model internally. But it is if you look at the documentation, it is if you look at ES documentation, you see it as ES rendering model. So if you go to ES2 documentation, you can find more details about it. But what I want to highlight is we have solved some of the previously mentioned issues. So if you were here for Sagar's talk, he talked about this store experience with WSO2, and that is built on top of this new framework, right? The caramel framework or ES UI framework. So ES UI framework does few things, right? One thing it does is it the whole UI is not developed in a single piece. Instead, the UI elements are separately living in individual files, and it is a composition based model. Basically, think of if you are already familiar with Java tiles kind of composition. So this is something like that. So the whenever you see a UI view in a store, let's say storefront that has all these tiny icons and navigation bar and so forth, this navigation bar is coming from one file, the icons are coming from different file and so forth. So the whole UI is composed of 5-6 files. So, and on top of that, we have the extension model that lets you get an individual piece of that UI, that the individual file, and then write your own file on top of that, right? Without modifying the existing file. So, so the problems we have solved in this model is, now our own customizations now can share code. That is, for example, our ES20 code base is shared with the Greg 5x product base. So if you learn about one product, you automatically gain knowledge about the other product, as well as it is easier for us to maintain. If we give a patch for one product, it's automatically applicable for the other product, right? So another advantage is it's easier to migrate between versions for customized UIs. So, for example, we already have customers who have customized the Greg. So it is much easier than our previous model, not customized Greg. Greg product has already been customized. If you talk to some of our customers who are here, they have a customized Greg product, and then we recently did a new release within this week, Greg 5.1. All the customizations live in a separate folder, so you can download the new product, copy over the customized versions, and then do minimal work to update the extensions, and you can upgrade to the new version. So downside is that we end up creating a bit of a complex model. So we do have documentation, but the folder hierarchy and so forth turned out to be a bit more complex than we wanted, because we are addressing multiple tenants, and each tenant can have multiple RxD type, multiple store assets types, and it all has to be isolated from all the other tenants and so forth. So the folder structure ended up being a bit complex than we wanted. So with the future development of UI framework, what we want to do is get this even more simplified. I mean, simplify this to a much greater degree, so we can apply these principles to all our UI, all our new UIs we write. Okay, so We have started developing a library called UUF, because we always give acronyms for our products. So it started up being as a unified UI framework. But anyhow, we call it UUF. We didn't think of the principles first and then came up with a framework. We started developing a framework from the learned experience based on our ES model as well as our API manager experience. But at the end, we discovered that we are adhering to certain principles, and so I want to highlight those principles. So I'm going to get a bit theoretical here, but so this set of principles that are called solid principles. These are, if you just like Google solid principles for OOP design, you'll see them. So I have reordered them and just get rid of one of the principles that is not very relevant to us. So these principles are things you have to be concerned if you are designing a new object-oriented language, for example. So we are not designing a language per se, but we are designing a framework, but still these principles apply to us and describes what we are trying to do very well. So first principle is open-close principle. That means the units or the things in our framework should be open to extending but close to modification. So this is the key thing for us. That means any element in the system should be extendable by people without actually changing the code. So this is true for like most of the languages you are already working with. For example, if you write a Java class, you don't have to change the code of that particular Java class to extend that class, right? You write a new Java class and then extend that Java class, and then you write your modification there. So this is a principle you often see in many programming languages, but it's not well applied in the space of UI creation. So what we are trying to do is get all the best programming practices we know from developing backends, developing Java programs, and then applying them into the world of creating UIs. Because at the end of the day, they are both, you know, software creation, right? We are doing the same kind of thing in different domains. So we should be able to get the best practices we use in one world and apply it into the other world to make the process better. So second one is substitution principle. So again, you are all familiar with this principle, even by not by this name, which means that if you extend a class, let's say a class, you have a class T and you extend it to a class S, then everywhere in your code base, if you do a search and replace T with S, then the program still works, right? So this is a very basic principle in programming languages. But what does it buys us in UI spaces? With first one combined with the second one, then you can easily extend the UI without modifying the shipped code, basically allowing you to quickly go back to the factory mode, revert it, or come back and do the upgrade without, because the code is not touched. And the last two are not as very significant, but still we have somewhat dependency inverted nature to this framework. That is in Java world, what that means is that whenever a certain class needs another class, that class doesn't have to necessarily initiate that class. You'll ask the framework, dependency injection framework, or in the WSO2 world, the OSGI framework. We ask the OSGI framework, okay, I need a class of this certain type, and the framework will provide it for you. So in the UI world, what we have done is, so this particular UI is not aware, so this particular UI needs a logo, right? So, but I'm not going to initialize it. I'm going to let the framework pick the actual concrete implementation and push it to me, right? So again, single responsibility principle means you write a class only to particular address only a single requirement, right? So you package the classes nicely. Separate the different concerns into different classes. So that's what it means in Java. In UI also, we wanted to package pieces of UI rather than writing like CSS, for example, in a whole monolithic one file. We wanted to chunk it up. So you can write, let's say, navbar's CSS in a single file and so forth. And at the end of the day, framework will bring that all together and put them into a single place. Okay. So these are the keywords in the framework. One is the big one is the component. Component is something shareable. For example, that might be a login process. So when you are writing a new application, you don't write everything in that particular repo. You just say, okay, I need login. I need this RxT view, I need that user management part, and then you write your own pieces, and then the build framework will bring all the other things together and inject into your application. So this is basically what we do with Java. So like, we don't write all your code in your repo. You have some dependencies and you build it to get the end thing. So we just want to get the same best practices into UI world. Layout is the base HTML structure. The unit is what is like a class in Java, right? So this is that cohesive unit cohesive piece that I talked about that has a single responsibility. So I'll go a little bit into the structure of each of those. So layout is simply a piece of HTML with placeholders defined. So we want to keep this as simple as possible and like closer to UI domain as possible. So we haven't, like, whenever it is not necessary, we try to remove it from the framework. So this is just HTML, and we have the zone is again keyword. So layout is just the HTML. You have some empty holes where you can put stuff into. That's just it. So our default layouts, we have created few layouts to be used by all WSO2 new UIs based on Bootstrap, and we have themed in a certain way. So if we tomorrow we decide to go ahead and change, let's say, navigation piece to a little bit left, and we apply that change, and that change will apply to all the new UIs in WSO2. So this is the advantage of using this framework. So next one is this is the key piece unit, which is analog to a class file in Java, but in this framework we call it a unit. The difference is it's not a single file. Like if you think about a class, it's a single file, single dot Java file. Here it is made up of multiple sub-elements, which HBS, if you don't know, is called Handlebars Template, which is very simple templating mechanism where you have just write HTML and you can put curly braces and you can put some special keywords there. So again, now if you look at this unit, what it talks about is, okay, what I'm going to do is put this section of HTML into this zone. So in the earlier slide, we saw that we have defined a zone called brand here, right? So and in this unit is talking about that zone. Okay, I'm going to put this push this section of HTML into that previously mentioned, you know, previously defined brand zone. So only link between units and layouts are through these zone names. So therefore, we can like seamlessly switch layouts. Like for example, like if you are doing a layout where everything is left to right navigation, or you want to, instead of fluid layout where you fill the whole screen, you want to do like a fixed width UI, then you can simply change the layout and without touching all the units, because units are only only know the layout by the zones, it works. So and few more things, like we don't want to hard code any URLs into our products, because that's a terrible thing we have done in some places, but we have learned from that, and most of our new UIs don't hard code any URLs. But going forward, we are even bring that in even more dynamic. So what we can do is get all the static files a dynamically generated UI, and then all the non-static files different UI. So you can route all the static files, for example, through a content delivery system, you can publicly host them somewhere else, so it doesn't even hit your servers. So your server hit is very minimal. Your dynamic content will be pulled there. All the images and everything is just served from a static HTTP server, if you really want speed. So those are like all the small improvements we have done on top of the framework. So basically, you define HTML, and you can recursively define more zones here as well. So and then finally, we define a JSON file, just to give this an optional JSON file to tell the system where this unit is applied. Otherwise, it is composed. So here, so you can see that dependency inversion pattern, where we push into some URLs rather than those components in that URL requesting in this unit, for special units like logo or footer or even navigation, certain pieces of navigation, you don't want those to be included from everywhere. Rather, you want it the other way around. The dependency should be other way around, where the unit, the lower element is pushing to the bigger element. So that's the whole dependency inversion principle we talked about. So this is saying, okay, I want this logo to be displayed in all the URLs, just, you know, everywhere in your app. So I'm going to finish just by showing you a quick sample. So so we have this is a sample application. It's not a sample application. This is basically the base application that will be used by all the applications in WSO2 in the future. So we have a base application, and that what we have done is introduce copied a folder that has this particular structure, right? And then it will change to this. So the difference between from existing stuff is that you didn't touch any code or any configuration that's existing, but you added, right? Therefore, even if you upgrade to the new version, your change to the logo will be automatically be there. Okay, so that's pretty much it. So you can check the core framework out in WSO2/carbonuuf repo, and we have we are already developing tooling for this in WSO2 incubator repository, and also we are working on creating this base UI that will be used across the products, as well as we have done some UIs to get the feel, because we can't just write a framework without doing something actual. So we have done some device management UI using this. So that is where we are now. So we're planning to push this and make it uniform across our product, so we can say, okay, if you have a WSO2 product, this is how you're going to customize, and this is how you deploy the, you know, migrate a new UI and so forth. So thank you.